Golden Knights having great success so far this year. Does that put any pressure on you guys to succeed in this
Who are the Golden Knights? only pressure is that the sniping of people saying you got to do as good as them.
It's just good. Vegas is treating us well, and I think the record doesn't show how hard that we work, and it's tough in that way, but it's good for us in the inner circle to understand what we have going on in Vegas, and if we just continue to trust and believe in each other, the sky's the limit for this team, and I'm blessed to be a part of it.
Our expectations maybe at the start of the season were a little unrealistic.
Man, we're not even worried about the playoffs right now. What we do is we take it week by week. We gotta worry about next week. You start looking ahead and you start looking over people, you might not even make it. So
that being said, to me, Urban Meyer is one of the lowest pieces of garbage there is on this earth.
You are tuned in to Straight Bet Sports live on the Gorilla Cross Radio Network.
Man, Wednesday night. You already know what it is. Straight Bet Sports, you are tuned in live here on the Gorilla Cross Radio Network. We greatly appreciate you giving us a few moments of your time tonight. I'm your host, Jose V, EMB up in the studio with Quan59, doing what he does for us behind the big board every single Wednesday night. Thank you so much for chiming in tonight and tapping in. Ladies and gentlemen, 702-608-3259 is the number here if you want to chime in tonight. We do have a guest, but after the guest, we will be taking phone calls tonight if you guys want to call us up. We had some phone calls last week. Hopefully, we can do some more this week. But again, man, like I ask you guys every single week, right? Press that like, press that share, drop a comment, and we'll go from there. Let everyone know what it is that you are watching tonight. Ian, was good, my guy? You good? I brought you a Red Bull today. You asked for a sugar-free one, so I guess you don't want to be too hyped. But there's a lot going on in the NFL, bro, so I know you're hyped about that, and we're going to talk about that shortly.
We got a lot to talk about, man. It's going to be a good show. We have a lot for you guys, and I can't wait to get in it, man.
And once again, we are coming to you live on Gorilla Cross Radio. If you guys have not done so already, if you have an iPhone, Apple Store, download the app today, Gorilla Cross. If you have an Android phone, same thing, Google Play Store, look up Gorilla Cross. You would find the app there. Check out all the content they have on there, not just our show. Trust me, you will not be disappointed. They have a wide variety of shows, different type of culture and stuff like that. It's an amazing thing, man. Go check it out. And of course, GorillaCross.com. We are live on all of their platforms. So what I mean by that, if you're a YouTube fan, check them out. Gorilla Cross on YouTube. We're live there. Twitter, we're also live on Twitter, Gorilla Cross. And of course, Facebook, Gorilla Cross, we're live there. And if you want to check us out after the show, let's say you missed today's show or any of our previous 100 episodes, because we're actually at 102, 103, I believe, now as of tonight, you can find us on YouTube, Straight Bet Sports. You'll find all of our audio video there. And I'm sorry, audio is all over Apple, Anchor, Spotify, Google, and Gorilla Cross as well. Check it out. Anything you want to listen to from our previous episodes, everything is there. We have a great guest tonight. A lot of people to thank, a lot of people to talk about later on in the show. But the guest that we have tonight, it's perfect timing because baseball season is literally a few weeks away when it comes to opening day, right? We're in the middle of smack dab of spring training now, even though it started a bit late, but we're going to have a full season here. So it was good to have and bring someone on that is in the game and knows what's going on from behind the scenes and get his thoughts and ideas and aspects on what's going on, right? Definitely. But before we get into that guest, obviously we got to pay some bills as we do here every single Wednesday night. Our sponsor, if it wasn't for him, Joshua LaFon, we wouldn't be live. So let's go ahead and let you know a little bit about Joshua here.
We are brought to you by Joshua LaFon with Simply Vegas Real Estate, a realtor here to help educate current and future Las Vegas locals on selling and investing in real estate. You're probably asking yourself, educate. Yes, there's a surprising amount of adults that when it comes to real estate, don't know the right questions to ask, don't know where to start, and think they need a lot of cash to buy a house in Nevada, which simply isn't true. So Josh has decided to make it his responsibility to teach his clients what they need to know, and equally important, what they need to ask to help ensure making their home ownership dreams a true reality. So make sure you call or text Joshua LaFon today at 702-813-0533. This has been another paid advertisement from Joshua LaFon with Simply Vegas Real Estate. Make sure you give him a call, 702-813-0533.
Shout out to everyone chiming in on all things social media as well, man. Joe checks in every single week, man. He's been chiming in, letting us know on Twitter. Best show, he says. He hits us up, man. We greatly appreciate that. Primo Eddie, man, my cousin, my blood, my family, been riding with me since day one, man, following every single episode. We greatly appreciate him. Kev Ray, he says, what's up, Straight Bet? Kev Ray, obviously, on No Plays Off Sports Talk with Ms. Ball and D here on Gorilla Cross Radio as well. And then Nate, Mike, Tim, everybody on Twitter, man, chiming in as they've been supporting for the last couple months, man, helping us grow, right?
Yeah.
Our Twitter views have gone through the roof.
Exponentially.
It doesn't matter where the views come from. As long as people are watching and people are entertained, right? Yep. And the fact that our views are going up just shows that we're obviously doing something right. So we appreciate it. We're doing a little something,
right? Every once in a while, you know, we get it right.
Every little bit counts, right, from time to time. But
1% better every day, right?
Correct. And then Mike chimes in, 109-104 Philly. Let's go, baby. I got the Lakers a money line in the second half. We'll talk about that later, though. But
it's okay. I don't hold it against you.
I know, Mr. Philly fan. But look, man, you guys see the Dodger hat. You guys saw the post the last couple days, and you guys saw the post today talking about who our guest is, he is none other than Okoye Dickson, right? He is a former major leaguer with the Dodgers, also played overseas in Asia a little bit, and now he's in the Dodgers minor league system, batting coach here. And I've talked to him already. We've had him on Spaces. That's where I met him on Twitter, talking all things baseball. He happened to jump into one of our Spaces and was cool enough to answer some questions. So I thought, why not bring him on the show, right? Like I said, baseball season's a few weeks away. We're getting ready to crack that bat and get going. I'm excited. I'm going to be going to a lot of Aviator games. I know you are too. And I actually, speaking of going to games, I got a surprise for you, but I'll let you know that at the end of the show. You're off Sundays, so I'll just leave it at that. But with all that being said, right, let's just jump into our guest. And I'm a little excited. It's the first baseball guest aside from Camden Perry, local product here in Las Vegas. Big shout out to Camden that we've had on the show. So with that being said, let's go ahead and jump into our guest now. He's joining us from Arizona, I believe, for spring training, because that's where they're doing their thing out there right now. I know it's a bit late, Okoye, and you're busy, man, and you said that you were going to make some time for us, so we appreciate you, man. I know our show is a little bit on the later side, but let's go ahead and welcome in Okoye Dickson. Welcome in, my man. How you doing tonight out there?
How's it going, man?
What's going on, fellas, man? I'm good, man. Appreciate y'all having me on tonight.
Definitely, my man. I told you when we first started meeting up on Spaces and started talking baseball and just having all those sports conversations that we have on Twitter, which is such a big community. It's funny how you get to meet different people and just start connecting with a lot of people. The networking is huge, and we appreciate you coming on the show tonight. Where exactly is it that you are right now that you told me?
So I'm in North Phoenix right now, about 20, 25 minutes away from the Dodgers complex right now, so.
Okay, definitely. So before we get into, obviously, everything MLB right now, everything going on with the Dodgers and the organization and what you can give us from what you're seeing with the players that you have there, wanted to talk to you a little bit about yourself, right? For people that don't know you that much, that possibly haven't heard of you coming into this show, right? How did you get into baseball? Like, overall, what was it about baseball that ended up being your sport, or were you playing other sports previous to you making baseball your niche?
Man, so I grew up in San Francisco, California, man. Obviously growing up, big-time Giants fan. Obviously Barry Bonds to, you name it. Even having Emmanuel Burris on the staff here with the Dodgers, man. Big-time Giants guy growing up. So, like I said, man, I just kind of got into ball, when I was young. My dad really, pushed me, into that baseball culture, because he used to actually play. He played a year with the Giants professionally in the minor leagues as well. So he just pushed me, man, and it's just a sport that, I just wanted to continue to keep playing and, keep learning and getting better. And I had some really great coaches, throughout my younger years to push me and, to keep me, grounded in a sense. So I just grew up loving the game and, just getting a passion for it and, started to become a little bit better each and every year, man. Was fortunate enough to, play at Sonoma State, Division II in Northern California up in Napa. And then got fortunate enough to get drafted by the Dodgers in the 12th round back in 2011, man. So, obviously, spent 7 years in the minor leagues with the boys in blue and finally got a chance to get called up in 2017, late in the season in September. And then ended up having surgery right after the year and end up going to Japan and played a little bit in Mexico too, man. So just a whirlwind of experiences that I had, but I'm truly grateful, man, for my time as a player. And now I'm just ready to give that, everything back to the game and, help these young guys get a chance to make it to the big leagues for sure.
The one thing that I've noticed about baseball, especially since I started covering out here with the minor leagues, is that I realized that baseball is one of those sports that even if, let's say, you don't end up staying in it as a player, you can continue as a coach for a very long time or just stay in the game itself, right? So, but like in your case now, you're still with the Dodgers, correct? Forgive me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, that's correct.
So how did that come about? Did you just keep that relationship open with the Dodgers the whole time, even? Because I know when you went to go play overseas for a while, did you still keep that communication open with them? Like, hey, if this doesn't pan out for me, I'd like to stay here and still do something with the club.
Yeah, so I don't think nothing was really discussed too much when I left and signed in Japan. But obviously, man, we got a great culture. We got a great group of guys that just make it feel like family, you know. So when I was kind of going through this process over the last 4 or 5 months, you know, I interviewed with a few other different clubs, you know, maybe to become a scout a little bit with a hitting coach organization as well. So my agent kind of reached out to the Dodgers, man, and, you know, they had a spot open, you know. So I interviewed for about, you know, 2 to 3 weeks, and things kind of came together quickly, you know, right before Christmas. And, you know, a lot of those guys who were kind of first or second year guys in the front office, you know, were still here. So it kind of made those relationships a little bit easier to talk to and, you know, get that hiring process kind of going a little bit more. So it was good, man. So it's just a nice, easy transition to come back to an organization where I have a lot of history with and a lot of people that I know. So it's been good.
So now you're a hitting coach, and in 2017, like you said, you went into the majors for a little bit. I think it is a 7-game stretch. And so obviously there's a major difference between minor and major league baseball. So how do you get your hitters ready for that jump, whether it be just a fill-in or they're actually going into the majors as full-time starters? And I assume it's AAA, right, that you're doing minor league hitting coaching for?
So I'll actually be in low A, so our low A group that will be in Rancho Cucamonga, so which is about an hour away from LA.
Okay.
But yeah, but kind of back to Ian's point, how would you go about that? Because you spent a lot of time in the minors, which, again, there's nothing wrong with that. A lot of people do that, and they make a great career of that and continue to be in baseball. But how do you teach that? Is there a difference between the minor league style of hitting as where you're trying to teach them how to hit in the majors?
Yeah, so I think the biggest thing for the young guys, man, is just understanding, having a routine and a plan, you know, and having an approach when they get in the box, you know, because we're going to have a lot of, you know, 18, 19, 20-year-old guys, you know, in A-ball. So just trying to teach these guys how to have a plan each and every day, you know, trying to become a big leaguer as far as how they prepare, how they get ready for each and every game, and how, you know, they're able to understand what the pitcher is trying to do to them each and every night. You know, so we have a lot of video, a lot of analytical stuff, a lot of heat maps and graphs that we're going to go over with these players at a young age, so that when they continue to move up, you know, to high A, double A, and triple A, they've already kind of went through the system as far as A ball of how to become a big leaguer, how to get ready each and every night for, you know, 95 to 101, you know, whatever the pitcher's going to throw that night. So just understanding, having a plan and how to become a big leaguer is, you know, is what I'm excited about to help these young guys, because we're going to have a lot of talent in Rancho to start the year. And obviously, as the year goes, you know, guys are going to move up and down, but we're going to have a really, really good, talented group in Rancho. So just trying to prepare these guys for that next step and just understanding how to become a big leaguer, even in A-ball. You know, so where you're at this year is your big leagues. And obviously, if you're, you know, blessed enough to be like a Juan Soto to go from A-ball straight to the big leagues, yeah, you know, kudos to you. But like I said, I look forward to helping those guys, you know, prepare and become big leaguers for sure.
Okoye Dickson, Los Angeles Dodgers batting coach for a single-A baseball team here, joining us live on Straight Bet Sports on the Gorilla Cross Radio Network, talking all things baseball and his career as well. So I wanted to ask you something, and sometimes I ask questions, and I don't mean any disrespect by it, but I like to just, you know, ask a straight question to you. Obviously, you're still in the game, and to me, if you play pro ball, whether it's 7 games, 1 game, whatever, you made it, right? In my opinion, you've made it. You worked hard. You've made it to that point. You got to the pro level. Now, some people make it longer. Some people last longer up there. You didn't last that long up there, but yet you're still in an organization. You're still with an MLB professional franchise doing things to continue your professional career, just in a different aspect of it. Now, you're in single A. You're dealing with a lot of younger talent, I'm pretty sure, not just a lot of vets, more than anything, a lot of more younger talent of guys that are coming through that farm system, trying to grow, trying to get to the single, the double, triple A's, Oklahoma City, and possibly move up to LA. I get that. What do you tell some of these guys that are a little bit impatient, right? Because some guys might be homesick. Yeah. Some guys aren't used to being away from their mom and dad, and you're sending them to a spring training in Arizona for a few months, and you're taking them away from their family. How do you work with those type of individuals, and how do you work with the ones that you know this guy's gonna, he's gonna be called up pretty soon, but I gotta mold him so his head doesn't get too big?
Right. So I think, you know, starting with the guys who could be homesick and trying to get those guys prepared and ready, I think the biggest thing is just, you know, showing that as a coach, just showing the guys that you're there for them. I think that's the number one key, just having that relationship, you know, building that foundation with them so that they can trust you and they can open up to you. You know, when things aren't going well, you know, things, you know, might be tough being away from home, they have an outlet to turn to. So I think for me, that's something that I value, is relationships, not just myself, but the Dodger staff in general. You know, all the coaches, all the front office people, they value the relationships and the family aspect as far as the organization. So I think just having guys, you know, come to you and trust you and know that, hey, they can come to you at any time, whether if it's, you know, in the morning, late at night, like, hey, I just need to talk, you know. So I think just building that relationship is going to be huge, and just understanding that, hey, I'm there for you, but also too, like, hey, pushing them in a sense to where, hey, you know, if you need a little pat on your back, great. You know, if you need a little encouragement, great. If you need to get pushed, you know, great. So I think those guys understanding that, hey, wherever you're going to be, show the organization that they made a mistake for putting you there and going out and balling and showing, you know, showing out. You know, and obviously for guys who, you know, some of our top prospects, you know, obviously just understanding, you know, how they go about it on a daily basis. Like, hey, you know, you're going to be in the big leagues here soon, but how are you preparing each and every day so that, you know, when you have to go catch Clayton Kershaw, or, you know, you have to go make a great play behind, you know, Walker Buehler or something like that, you know, the big league staff can trust you. So just understanding that, hey, my work that I'm doing in A-ball is the same work that I'm going to be doing when I get to the big league. So no matter where you're at, treat that as if that's your big leagues, so that when you get there, you're prepared and ready so that the organization doesn't have to send you back down. So that's kind of like the main keys for sure.
With you being a hitting coach, is there like a line of communication with you and the big league club with some of the coaches there? You know what I mean? Like maybe they're looking at what's out there talent-wise a little bit lower, trying to see what they can bring up throughout the year? Or is it just, you know, if someone gets hot, that's when the phone call gets picked up?
Yeah, so I think we're kind of all in a group chat as far as the hitting coaches. And, you know, obviously our big league hitting coaches want to make sure that guys are following certain plans so that when they get to the big leagues, they're ready and prepared. You know, so obviously when you get to double A and triple A, those are those real years to where you're really honing in on how to prepare to really get to the big leagues and understand when you're there, you're prepared. You know, so I think, you know, us kind of having a collective group of having that, you know, that text message group of, you know, hey, like this guy's working on this and that. We have an app called 42 that we use for a lot of the coaches so that we can kind of, you know, build resumes and just build notes and videos so that we know exactly what guys are working on each and every week so that, nice, you know, the organization is understanding what guys are working on and vice versa. You know, so they give us a plan. We try to, you know, crush it for the player and, you know, hopefully get that guy to the big leagues, you know, sooner than later for sure.
Now, like you said, there's a lot of young guys coming into single A, and I'm sure a lot of them came from high school. They were the big guy on campus, even in single A, right? How do you, like, for those players that think that they should be in double A or triple A or even the majors, how do you, I guess, curve expectations or bring them at least to a understanding that sometimes these things take time and you have to work on your game to get up to the majors?
Right, so I think the biggest thing, man, is just getting those guys to buy in and understand that, hey, where you start is not where you're going to finish. So that's going to be up to you.
Yes.
So just kind of challenging them in that aspect of like, hey, if you're starting in low A, your goal should be to be able to be in double A by the end of the year or to the big league. So having that mindset each and every day when you come to the field, you know, it's a mindset that you got to have. You know, so obviously as a coach, if you see a guy kind of going through the motions and kind of, you know, just having one of those days or weeks, you know, try to encourage him to keep going. You know, because obviously I spent 7 years in the minor league, so I know what that grind is like from the bus rides to the early morning flights in AAA and having to go play that night and get right back on the field the night or the next night. So just knowing what it feels like to go through that grind, but also to, you know, allowing these guys to know that, hey, you know, your goal should be, you know, getting to the big league. So whatever that you have to do, the sacrifices you have to make for your family, you know, push yourself to the limits because you only get one shot at this and you want to try to maximize it as much as possible. You know, so don't leave anything left until they rip it off you, you know, rip off that jersey, man. Yeah, just keep going.
So you talk about family and you and I text from time to time. I know you're busy and you hit me up when you can because you're up early and you're out all day basically coaching. Talk about and you don't have to get detailed of it, but how are those conversations with your family? Because you say you FaceTime a lot, right? You're FaceTiming your family a lot when it comes to you being away. How hard is that for you? Especially, I mean, you've gone through it as a player, but now being a coach, and I'm pretty sure you're out for a longer stretch because you're studying, you're doing film work, and you're doing all that. How are those conversations? Are they tough conversations for you to have, or is it something you're used to already?
Yeah, I think, you know, it never gets easy as you leave the house, for sure, because, you know, especially with two little ones at the house, it never gets easy, you know. So I think, you know, just understanding that, you know, having a wife that understands the baseball life is huge. And, you know, my wife's kind of been going through it since 2014. I did have a two-and-a-half-year break where, you know, I retired and, you know, started being home a lot more. So I think that transition now of me going back out is definitely taking a toll at home at times. But like I said, you know, I'm sacrificing, you know, my time for the family to have a greater opportunity here in the next, you know, year or two. You know, so I think, you know, just having those conversations, you know, each and every morning or right after lunchtime or before lunch and obviously after we're done with our, 1 o'clock games, you know, so just trying to make that time and show that, hey, you know, even though I'm away, you know, if I got 10, 15 minutes here to spend that time with you guys, you know, I think just owning that ownership of like, I'm going to make that time is the biggest key. And I think that's all, you know, a baseball wife can ask for, just, hey, as long as you make the time. You know, it's all good, you know, because they know we're grinding every day, up early, late at night, especially in spring training. So we got about 10 days left, you know, before it's, you know, kind of smooth sailing to where you get into your normal routine throughout the year. You know, you got a 6:30, 7 o'clock game, and, you know, you get to the field around 11 or 12. And, you know, just a little bit easier throughout the year instead of, you know, waking up at maybe 4:45, 5, and then not getting off the field till, you know, 4:35 o'clock. You know, it's definitely long days for sure.
So, Okoye, a couple more things here before we let you go. I know it's getting late. Didn't want to keep you up too much. But the one thing that I wanted to ask you before we ask the question that I know everyone wants to ask, obviously the whole Freddie Freeman thing and everything, get your thoughts on that. But we'll talk about that at towards the end here. But what is the end-all be-all for you? For Okoye, what is the end-all be-all when it comes to this? Where do you see yourself, let's say, 10 years from now, in this baseball coaching game that you're now in?
Man, honestly, man, like kind of coming into this, I've always had dreams of, you know, becoming a GM or you know, being a big league manager for sure. You know, and obviously I know, you know, a lot of our positions with the Dodgers are kind of, you know, tough to get to, you know, especially with guys that, you know, greater resumes at the moment right now. And obviously with Doc, you know, being the head guy, and obviously Andrew Freeman and a lot of the new assistant GMs, you know, so I know it's going to be tough with us, but I know for sure, you know, I know God is going to make a way to, you know, to get, you know, somewhere as a GM for sure. You know, so I think just having that passion of being around the game and becoming a manager, a big league manager as well, is something I've always dreamed about, you know, after I'm done playing, and just, you know, have a team to where, you know, guys can come to me, open door policy, man, if you need anything, you know, just come, you know, I just want to be able to help family, and obviously the player, and just make sure that, you know, you get the most out of your players, you know. So now being a coach, you know, I just want to make sure that, you know, I'm giving back to the game, man, doing it the right way and making sure I have that passion and that relationship for guys so that, you know, they can be able to get a chance to make it to the big leagues. Cause it's really hard, man. It's baseball has changed so much to the point where, you know, you got 8-ball guys throwing 100 miles an hour, oh, yeah, you know, on a nightly basis, you know? So if guys can handle that in 8-ball, you know, they should be able to handle it, you know, in the big leagues as well. Because, you know, they throw more strikes in the big leagues, so guys are going to be a little bit more around the plate, you know. So like I said, that's kind of like my dream, man, just to become a GM one day, man, you know, give back to the game, man, and become a major league manager for sure.
You know what I heard in that answer, Ian? I didn't hear anything about me. All I heard was everyone else. And that's awesome, bro, because the fact that all you care about is making everyone else around you and letting everyone else grow and be better, that's awesome, because you want to get into that power position, not to have the power, but to have it where you can help individuals. And that's amazing, man. I love that. I love to hear that, because when you hear me, 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 I used to be the me, me, me guy when I first started. I'm not going to lie. And I've come to realize it's a lot more than just me. There's so much more around you if you want to grow and be great. So I'm glad that you said that. Now, the final topic, final question, obviously, you're in the minor leagues. What are some of the guys that you're coaching right now, that you're around, that you say, hey, guys, watch out for these guys, whether it's in the next couple months, maybe in the next year or two? And normally when there's a big trade, the farm system gets freaking sold and given away, right? The Dodgers didn't necessarily do that here in the trade, but we also want to get your thoughts on the whole Freddie Freeman trade. This lineup with the Dodgers now, Turner, Freeman, I mean, it's just sickening to watch on paper. Obviously, we haven't seen it, you know, come out on the field yet, but what are some of the guys that we need to look out for and your thoughts on the Freddie Freeman trade?
So I think, you know, probably five guys to be on the radar this year. Obviously, I'm going to start with probably Miguel Vargas. I'm not sure if you guys saw some of the Instagram stuff today, but he ended up hitting a three-run homer off of Shane Bieber today.
Oh, nice.
Probably a guy that's probably going to maybe start in either Double-A or Triple-A, but he'll be definitely making his debut this year 100%. We got another guy named Michael Bush, a second baseman. He's a first-rounder a couple years ago. Definitely a guy that will probably make his debut at some point this year as well. We got a lot of young guys in camp, too. A guy named maybe Stefan Romero that just came back over from Japan. He'll probably get a shot to help out the big league club this year as well. Eddie Alvarez, a guy that came over in, I think, the Miami Marlins trade, I believe. A guy that was actually an Olympic skater, man.
What?
You know, it's crazy to think that he's an Olympic skater, but this guy is a Major League Baseball player as well. You know, so a guy that, you know, is fighting for that utility role. A guy that definitely has a shot to help out this team. And then another guy, obviously, our number one prospect, Diego Cartaya, a catcher. You know, from the first day I saw him in camp, you know, he's a big leaguer. Even though he'll be in probably A ball this year to start, you know, like I said, just being around this young kid, man, he's special. Catcher from Venezuela, you know, just a really talented guy, man. So I think, you know, those five guys will definitely have a shot to make their debut here soon. Obviously, you know, Diego might take a couple years, but definitely a guy you'll be seeing in the near future for sure. And obviously, you know, Freddie Freeman, yes. You know, signing him just put the icing on the cake, man. We're actually just out at dinner with a lot of our staff tonight and kind of talking a little bit of the GMs tonight about, you know, how the Freddie Freeman news kind of broke. You know, obviously when the Braves ended up trading for Matt Olson, you know, I think that was the kind of door that kind of led to, hey, the Dodgers, hey, we got a shot, you know, to get this guy. You know, so obviously adding him in the lineup to where, you know, Doc and all those guys, man, they're going to have so much fun putting that lineup together each and every night. You know, and I think sometimes people forget about how good Mookie Betts is, man. And, you know, just obviously having all these guys, man, it's going to be a fun team to watch, you know, and I look forward to, you know, seeing these guys, you know, finish everything off this year, man, to bring that title back to LA for sure. So I'm excited for the big league staff and for the guys that are getting ready to help that big league staff this year too. It's been a blessing to get a chance to work with those guys before Major League camp started, you know, so it's going to be a good year, man. This lineup is tremendous, man. And obviously, you know, we still got a lot of great, you know, pitching and obviously a lot of guys in the bullpen that's going to help, you know, win a lot of games this year too. So I'm excited.
Koya Dickinson, Los Angeles Dodgers minor league hitting coach, joining us here on Straight Bet Sports. Now, Okoye, I know you said you guys playing out in Rancho this year, so I visit back and forth to California. I'm in the Riverside area, so I won't be too far from there. So hopefully we can go catch you guys and watch some games here this season. But before we let you go, my man, I just want to say thank you so much for your time. Appreciate you following and supporting the show, because you like, you retweet, you comment on my stuff. So we greatly appreciate that from the bottom of my heart, especially a professional as yourself doing that. So thank you so much for supporting the show. But before we let you go, let everyone know out there on all things social media where they can find you and just follow you and your career and the Dodgers in general.
Yes, I appreciate you guys having me on, man. It's been a blessing, man, to get a chance to kind of share some of my story a little bit. And obviously, you know, just kind of give you guys a little insight on what, you know, some of the coaching staff kind of goes through on a daily basis in spring training and obviously throughout the year, man. So I appreciate you guys for sure. Pleasure getting a chance to meet you, Jose, you know, and obviously, you know, everything that you guys do, man, just keep going, man. I'll definitely, you know, look forward to maybe getting another chance to hop on here with you guys, maybe talk a little NFL football as well. And, you know, whatever else you guys want. But, you know, I tweet a little bit on, so I think on Twitter, my social media is Okoye23 and same for my Instagram. So if you guys want to shoot me a follow, go ahead, and I'll definitely give you guys a follow back, man. So I appreciate the love. Thank you.
There we go. Okoye Dickson, my guy, greatly appreciate you. You have yourself a great night, and we'll be chopping it up soon. And best of luck for the rest of the season coming up, my guy.
Good luck, man.
All right, thank you, fellas. Appreciate it.
Yes, sir. Okoye Dickson, Los Angeles Dodgers, minor league hitting coach there. Good stuff, man. Fun stuff. Again, first-time guests. We keep bringing new guests, different guests. Yeah. We have the same repeat guests from time to time, but they're good guests. They're not bad guests. We have a good time here on the show. We're halfway through the show, though, man. I'm going to read some of these comments. I got to give some love to our social media fam, obviously. Mo from Girl Chat Sports chimes in. She says, salute, Straight Bet Sports. Three hearts with the Dodgers. By the way, Lakers lost by 5. Cover the second half money line. Thank you so much. Kev Ray chimes in, says White Sox Dodgers in the World Series. That'd be interesting because you're a White Sox fan, so I get it, Kev. So we'll see how that. Joseph chimes in, says shuffle up the lineup. 1-9 for the Dodgers. Put them in any order. They'll still score 5+ runs. Laughing my you know what off. And then Primo Eddie chimes in, Lakers lost 126-121, which is fine with me because, like I said, they covered. And then again, Mac, Mike. I mean, Marie, I mean, we got everyone chiming in on Nate, Ish, everyone on Twitter, man. Everyone that's just chiming in. We got a comment on YouTube. Love the hat. Go Birds. They're talking about you. And I'm like, yes, there that's Ian. He's a young Eagles fan. I like to call that. But definitely, man, we're having a good time tonight, man. We're having a great time as we do every single Wednesday.
Let's actually shift a little bit.
What are we shifting to tonight, though?
Before we
shift, though, we have one more sponsor.
Okay.
We always got to do that because if not, we forget.
Yeah,
the show gets a little bit later. But one person that I will give a shout out to, because they basically are sponsoring us, you know, here in the next couple months with what we're doing, and decided to jump on with us and help us out. Mike Jones, man. Chef MJ. Follow him on Twitter. Hooked us up with the donation. You saw that. That was a big, big thing there. We greatly appreciate him.
He's been hitting a lot, guys. He's been winning a lot. Just follow him on Twitter, man. If you want to make money, go and follow Mike Jones. He's got you.
It's Chef, CHEF _MJ. Trust me, the guy is killing it, man. If you're a novice, whatever, trust me, you'll like to definitely hit them up. And of course, Sosa the Locksmith, Spin Doc, Rex, Andy Sports. All the guys over there at the Wise Guys Diamond Club, man, we greatly appreciate you guys and what you do, because they also support and help the show, retweet everything, which is amazing. They've helped us grow on Twitter, so we got to give love to the people that are helping us out. But of course, again, we have one more sponsor, and he is none other than Eric Navarro. I'm going to go see Eric on Friday. I shaved up the beard. The beard's coming back, so I need to get it cleaned up and lined up. But of course, here's Eric Navarro of Line 'Em Up by Eric, as you see there on the screen, 702-884-8138, if not on IG, Line 'Em Up by Eric. Hit him up. Download the Booksy app if you want as well. A lot more easier. You can book your appointment, leave a comment, leave a review. You're good to go. Hit up Eric today. Eric Navarro, 702-884-8138. Line him up by Eric. He is cutting out a 5-star barbershop on Ann Road and Simmons. Let him know Jose V and EMB and Quan 59 over here at Straight Bet Sports Gorilla Cross sent you. He'll definitely take care of you guys. But let's shift into some football talk, because
before we do, real quick,
okay,
because we do have a lot of what football talk. Who won the MLB free agency so far? Because there's been a lot of moves.
You gonna throw that curveball at me just because baseball?
Hey, there's been a lot of moves. Chris Bryant to the Rockies. You have with the Phillies, they signed Castellanos.
You know what? Okay. I'm glad you say that. I don't want to cut you off.
Schrauber.
Chris Bryant. We're going to talk about Schrauber first.
Okay.
The Chris Bryant one was kind of interesting to me because it came out that the Giants said they didn't want to bring him back, but yet he's from the Bay Area, I believe that, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's like... It's kind of...
Chris Bryant's from Vegas. From here. He went to Bunzana.
Him and Bryce Harbor. You're right. Yep. Him and Bryce Harbor
were... He went to Bunzana.
So that was another thing. People, I mean, just...
Bonanza.
It,
Not Bonzana.
I thought he was going to stay in San Francisco. Say that again. Yeah,
I said Bonzana.
Bonzana?
Bonanza. Yeah. Tongue twister, I guess. I don't know.
Oh, my God. Really, Ian?
Yeah.
Really, bro?
Yeah.
Are you drinking or what's going on?
No.
I mean, you know, you got to go.
I'm not drinking.
I mean, you know, if it's not seen, you know, what can I say? But, I mean, if I'm being honest with you, I don't think that there's an actual team, just one team. I think that this MLB free agency one, if that makes sense, because a lot of the moves that were made were good moves to the spots. There wasn't anything necessarily that was wow, like over the top wow. Granted, Freddie Freeman was kind of a last minute, you know, back and forth type of thing. Some people said Red Sox, some people said LA.
Eddie Martinez says the Dodgers did.
The Dodgers, but, of course, he's a Dodgers fan. He's gonna say
so. I know I sound like a homer, but I really
every
do. I do really like what the Phillies did.
Okay, tell me why.
It's going to be hard to get past that lineup. I mean, you got Schwarber, you got Castellanos, you still got Bryce Harper and Segura, and JT.
You all right? Can you breathe? Let it out, bro.
Yeah. You got JT.
Okay.
So, I always have trouble with his last name. But what did you say, Quan? I didn't hear you.
I said Bonzana.
I don't know what to say to that. He got you, bro.
Listen, we wouldn't have even known if he didn't correct himself.
This is true. This is true. Okay.
But now I'm never going to let you live that.
Yeah,
down.
Eddie Martinez. Of course he's I'm a Philly fan. Yeah.
We might have to make that a gift.
Through and through. That being said, since I can't pronounce anything tonight, let's just go straight into NFL talks right now.
But did you get in time to put it up, the graphic, or no, Quan? Cool. So what do you want to start with? Let's start with the whole Matt Ryan situation, right?
Okay.
Let's talk with that because you wanted to talk about who won the NFL free agency, and then we can jump into the other quarterback circle here. But obviously, we see here Matt Ryan goes to the Colts for a sixth. Well, sorry, not a sixth-round pick. I'm over here reading this wrong. So he goes to the Colts, which is the sixth major quarterback move already this season, right?
Yeah.
So far, and you ask who has won this, right?
Yeah.
Who has won these moves, and which quarterback will have more success? Who do you think?
So, I think that Matt Ryan definitely went into the right spot, but I think Russell Wilson actually probably won in terms of where he's going, because not only do they have a solid offense around Russell, but they have a good GM, they have a good defense, they've been making really good picks in the last couple of years. So he is in a team that's built right now to win. I would argue that offensively is probably the best receiving core together, all together, including everyone that receives for Russell Wilson. So I would say that he probably is going to have the most instant success. However, I do think Deshaun Watson went into the...
So hold on, slow down.
Okay.
You're getting ahead of yourself.
I'm getting a little ahead of myself.
Let's stick to the whole Matt Ryan thing first here, right? Obviously, you brought up Russell Wilson, which, of course, there's so many different quarterback situations that happened this year. We're going to get into those right now. But Matt Ryan, let's backtrack a bit.
Okay.
Him going to the Colts. A lot of people said that the Colts were a win team now last year, that Carson Wentz could possibly be a guy. This was before any games were played.
Yes.
That he could be that guy coming in with the one-year deal or two-year, whatever it was, to possibly get them there, right? We saw how they basically choked away their playoff hopes towards the end. Now, this team possibly has the top, if not top three running back in the league right now, if we're being honest with Jonathan Taylor.
Yeah, absolutely.
The kid's
probably
a beast.
Top one or two,
the
easily.
The kid's a beast, nonstop, and he's still young and fresh, which is great.
Yeah, he's 25
that offensive line
years old.
Is a whole lot better. They've helped him a lot, obviously, because he's a young kid. You want to protect that. You want to protect your investment. They're still solid when it comes to receiving core. You still got T.Y., which is a veteran. You still got some younger guys that are there. But that defense, Matt Ryan hasn't had a great, great defense in a while. I'm not saying the Colts are a great defense, but they're better than any defense that Matt Ryan has had in a while in Atlanta right now. The whole defensive core that the Colts have right now, you have to agree, is better than what he's had in Atlanta in the last couple years.
He is moving to a better situation.
And he's staying in the dome, bro.
He's staying in the dome. He is moving to a better situation. In my opinion, a better coach. I'm not sold on Arthur Smith. However, this is the thing. He's never had this depleted of a receiving core. If you really think about it, even last year, he had Russell Gage and he still had Kyle Pitts. And Kyle Pitts came into his own. He was over 1,000 yards as a tight end, right? Here, I mean, they have, like you said, an aging T.Y. Hilton. He's not who he used to be. And they just got rid of Pascal. They only have really Michael Pittman Jr. That's really his only solid target. And yes, he has Jonathan Taylor. He has a good offensive line. But we're going to see if he's able to really pick apart those secondaries without much of a receiving core. Now, I would believe that they're going to make some trade during draft day to try to move up, maybe in the second round, third round, whatever, to try to get him some help in the receiving core area. But I really think that their window kind of closed with the fact that they can never get that quarterback situation right when they needed to. If they got Matt Ryan maybe like 3 years ago, I would have agreed with you. I would have thought that he was stepping into a situation ready for success now. But I think the Colts team, as well as their now new quarterback, is a little past their prime.
But what I'm saying here, and now I want to get it clear, is that I'm not saying that he's going to go there and win a Super Bowl. I'm not saying he's going to go there and be Peyton Manning. But he's going into a better situation than he's had in Atlanta in a while.
Yes.
Julio Jones hasn't been the receiver he's been in the last couple of years with injuries and everything else. Kyle Pitts, very inconsistent last year. If you think about it, he had 1,000 yards, but he also had a stretch there where he couldn't be found. So what I'm saying is... Yeah.
He is a rookie.
I get that. And he was put all the pressure because Ridley wasn't doing that much. Julio Jones was out, so I get that. I totally understand that whole scenario, right? And you got to put a lot more
Ridley
pressure on the kid.
Gambling. That's what Ridley was doing.
Ridley was having fun and gets suspended for the whole year when other guys put their hands on women and you know, they don't get a whole year. But anyways, that's a whole other whole topic. You know how I feel about that garbage. But it's going to be interesting, man. There's a lot of quarterback moves, obviously, that happen. A lot of free agency moves in general. The NFL is going to be a whole different landscape to view this season with the quarterback situations. But we have two more quarterbacks, obviously, right? One of them is going to basically be jobless here shortly, as where the other one has taken his job in Deshaun Watson. We see now Deshaun Watson going to the Cleveland Browns, which surprised a lot of people, which it came out of nowhere. But obviously, when a team comes in to guarantee you that type of money, it's hard for you as a player to say, I'm not going to take that money right now. Before I let you jump in and give me your thoughts and talk about that, I want to talk about how I feel about this situation. Now, I understand that he's got about 20 to 22 lawsuits, whatever it is, that are civil lawsuits, right? We don't know how much he's going to have to pay that in those lawsuits.
Yeah.
I was going at it with Sosa in a space the other day, and he was talking about how, well, it's not about the money. He didn't go to Cleveland because of the money, because those lawsuits are going to be like $23 million, and that's about it, and he'll be fine. He's going to pay out a way more than $23 million. He'll probably pay one person $23 million. I'm just saying. That's how crazy it is when people try to take money from you because they have something against you. Not only that, a lot of these women that didn't testify have already signed waivers, have already signed stuff because they have an agreement in place to get paid by Deshaun Watson. Now, they offered him the most guaranteed money of anyone else, right? Yeah. Think about that. So that's one scenario. Why not take that money when it's the most guaranteed money that you can take, when you know you're going to have to pay out a lot of lawsuits coming up shortly here, right? That's one. Not only that, two, great, great job by the front office of the Cleveland Browns. For the first time in a long time, they restructured his deal where he's only getting paid $1 million next year. And if he gets suspended half of the season or whatever, he's not losing that much in paychecks and game checks because of his salary. That's two. Three, I do believe, aside from the money, aside from having to pay any of these lawsuits out and needing that money, he came to Cleveland because I think Cleveland gives him the best situation to win now, if we're being honest. Great running game, great defense, right? The whole receiving corps situation is a bit shaky now because of what's going on.
They did just get Amari Cooper, though. And
they signed him, too. Hold on.
Granted, he's only 27. People think that Amari is like 30 or something like that. He's only 27, which is nuts because it seems like he's been in the league forever.
And hold on. And yes, they got Amari Cooper. That's the other point I was going to get to. Amari Cooper's still very, very serviceable. So you're giving him a number one in Amari Cooper, right? But the other thing, too, a lot of people like to make fun of, well, Mitchell Trubisky has a better record than his, because I put that out there joking around. But the statistics are completely different.
Yeah.
Deshaun Watson had an MVP-type season with no one on the offensive side of the ball. Absolutely nobody. And he made it happen. So I don't think that him going to Cleveland is a downfall. Now that I've looked at the whole scenario around it, I think it's a win-win situation for Deshaun Watson and the Cleveland Browns. Do I see them winning a Super Bowl or a championship anytime soon? Probably not. Do I see them getting better? 100%, because I think Deshaun Watson, even though he's been out, makes them better before he's even stepped on the field.
Oh, I think this is the closest Cleveland, and it seems premature to say that, right? But I think this is the closest that the Browns are actually to a championship 30, 40 years.
Remember how much we were talking about them last season before the season? And then now this is probably the more legitimate
you
reason
just
to
said
talk
it.
About it.
Deshaun Watson has been able to, like, putting up points, it doesn't matter who's on that offense. Putting up points, never been
he's
problem
a Madden
for
quarterback,
Deshaun,
bro. He's a Madden quarterback.
Watson. He is absolutely outstanding as a quarterback. On the field, probably top two, top three, right? He's never really, he has early his rookie year, but that defense started kind of falling apart. Injuries, just people getting old. This is an amazing defense. We do, like you said, we talked about it last year. They really didn't have to give too much up on that defense. In fact, I don't think they had to give up anything on that defense. And now he just is required to put up points. He has a true number one receiver. And
great running game.
Great running game.
Two-headed and, monster.
Yeah, they still have Kareem Hunt. They still
and
have
you
Nick
have
Chubb.
A defense. Think about this. When he was in Houston, yeah. He had J.J. Watt on that side of the defense.
But
you got Myles Garrett now.
Yeah, outside of Watt,
but I'm saying you have Myles
helping.
Garrett
you have,
yeah. And more. It's not just Myles Garrett, which is good, man. Definitely. Once
you have an entire defense that's going to stop points. So as long as he can put points up, I think they're automatically a 10-12 win team now.
So look, I don't want to cut you off, but there's a bunch of people going off having conversations about the show while the show's going on Twitter, which
that's
is amazing.
That's
of course
that's,
I'm over
that's a great thing.
Shout out to Mac, Nate, where's she at, my homie Sima Betts, and then Lady D. Well, no, right, yeah, Miss Lady D. She's like, I was supposed to be at the studio today, but she went out and got drunk, and Quan's over here shaking his head. He's like, nope. Hey, you've been saying to Miss Lady D that Quan don't want to invite me. Quan just said you're the one that keeps saying you're gonna come to the studio and don't come. Oh, he's grabbing the mic.
She knows she's invited every time. She hasn't even been to the new studio, so I know we haven't seen her for at least 2 years. A little over 2 years.
Quan said it on me.
I just hit her up a couple days ago because I saw her in Vegas. And she still hasn't come through. And she was downtown, so you
that's
could
what
walk
she said
down
now,
here in 20 minutes.
Exactly.
From the D or wherever you're at downtown, Circa. No excuses.
Show ends in 12 minutes. You can get here in 12 minutes, and we can still say hi to you if you want. But the door is wide open. The invitation is there. But real quick, before you continue with that, I got to give a big shout out to Mike Davis. Good friend of the show. Mike Davis, general manager and head coach of the Vegas Nighthawks. They won their first game of their franchise's existence to start off. Great win here at the new Dollar Loan Center. They play again this Sunday at 1 p.m. at the Dollar Loan Center again against the Tucson Sugar Skulls. Game is at 1 p.m. Ian, that was my surprise to you, bro. We're going to get credentials. We're going to be at that game. Excellent. If you can make it. I know you're off Sundays. So I'm telling you now, get
definitely,
a babysitter.
Definitely will do this.
Grab the little man.
Much
put him in the
I
closet.
Can.
I don't know what you got to do, bro, but figure it out. Just don't tell nobody if you put him in the closet because I don't want you to get in trouble. But we got to figure that out. Yeah. We're going to get to that game. That's one. And then Aviators right around the corner as well. And then another shout out that I got to give before we continue on here. Las Vegas Lights, baby. All of the credit to the coaching staff and the players. It shows what a good coaching staff, camaraderie, training, and everything can do to a team. 2-0 to start the season. 5-4 today. They were up 3-1. Crazy. I took them plus 650 in game. I'm like, why not? Let's take a chance. Sprinkle 10 bucks on them. Nothing crazy. I'm not going to lie to you and act like I put a lot of money on it. They hit 2-0 to start off the season. Win the home opener, win the road season home opener, 2-0 on the season. Great way to start. Gotta solidify the defensive side of the ball a little bit more. Not gonna lie to you about that. If you guys saw the game, you guys know what I'm talking about. But big shout out to the Las Vegas Lights FC, their franchise, their team, the players, the coaches. Great win. Continue. They play again this Saturday here at Cashman, so that should be fun. Brett, still waiting on that phone call and email, my guy. Let me know. But anyways,
one more
continue.
Shout out.
Yeah.
I got a shout out too. Shout out to Lady Rebels and Lady LaRock.
Yes, sir.
Excellent season.
Big shout out.
Huge season. They did fall short in the NCAA tournament. It was a close game. It is a very close game, and they played their hearts out. So huge shout out to the Lady Rebels.
And then if you guys were watching the game, the ESPN commentators gave her huge, huge praises. They said she is literally the best young college coach in the game right now. Look it up if you don't believe me. So for her to get that type of praise from a huge national network like that, that's amazing. So big shout out to Lindy LaRock. We're going to have her on the show again soon. I'm pretty sure we got to talk with her again, see what the season's got coming up. I know she's excited already. She's probably already out there recruiting. I wouldn't be surprised. This never stops for them. But, Ian, we got about 10 minutes here, my guy. We got NBA. I mean, we got a couple more NFL.
I wanted to talk about what you got. I wanted to talk about real quick the wide receiver market.
Okay, right? Let's do that.
So Tyree, for anyone that
start. Hold on.
Okay.
Hold on. We got to start with this because I just remembered because you brought it up from last week's show. Before the show ended last week, I said, "Nah, Davante Adams ain't going to the Raiders." Very next day, he goes to the Raiders.
Yep.
Now, yeah. Christian Kirk broke the bank. That's why we saw what Davante Adams gets. Before you talk about Tariq Hill and what happened today, Derek Carr has no more excuses now.
Yeah.
Like, no, at this point, everyone, including myself, if you want to call me a Derek Carr apologist, there is no more excuses this year. It's either win now or I'm sorry, we need to move on. Mariota got his bag. He got paid. He's going to Atlanta. So we're going to see now who's the guy, right?
Yeah, we are. And this is the crazy thing. We were talking about that Christian Kirk deal when it first came out, and we're like, man, that's a lot of money for Christian Kirk. He's never had 1,000 yards. Davante Adams and Tyreek Hill shattered that number. I just absolutely obliterated that number into space. Jesus, so Davante Adams, I think his contract comes out to around $28.5 million a year, right? It's, I think, $142.5 million over 4 or 5 years. And that's a lot. He's 29. He'll be 34 by the end of that contract. I'm sure there's ways to move it around. But I agree with you. Derek Carr, no more excuses. Between Darren Waller, Adams, and Renfro, you really have. And Jacobs, as well as Kenyon Drake is still there, right?
Like Primo Eddie says, just win, baby.
Just win. You have no excuse. It's your time to shine. On the other note, Tyreek Hill, in case everyone watching has not been paying attention today, Tyreek Hill just got traded to the Miami Dolphins.
Insane, bro.
So
insane.
So Tua has to make it because this is the thing. Miami has 2 first-round draft picks next year. I think they have 2 second-round draft picks next year. If he does not, there's CJ Stroud, there's Bryce Young coming out. And CJ Stroud had a pro day today. He looked absolutely fantastic. You now have Waddle, Devontae Parker, which I don't think Parker will be.
He's still serviceable.
I don't think he'll be on the roster midway at the time. Yeah, I think he'll get traded. But you have Cedric Wilson from the Cowboys they just paid. You have Waddle, and now you have Tyreek Hill and Gesicki. Like, you have so many weapons there. If they don't get it done, like, if Tua doesn't make the playoffs this year, then they have to move on.
Not only that, bro, you have to protect this kid, though. You could have these offensive weapons, but you have to protect him, is what I'm saying, because of his injury. So not necessarily is it, does Tua have an out here, but you have to protect him as well.
So they just also signed Connor Williams, which is the guard from Cowboys, very serviceable guard. And then they just signed All-Pro Armstead.
Okay. Yep.
So,
yeah, I forgot about that.
So as their left tackle. So, like I said, no excuses. They rebuilt the offensive line. They gave him weapons. He has to make it this year. Otherwise, I think they're going to move on. On the flip note, with the wide receivers making the money that they're making right now with Tyreek Hill and Adams' contract, I am sure that we're going to see in the next couple of years a lot more wide receiver prospects that are getting picked in the first round that wouldn't maybe necessarily make it in the first round. Like, they would have been, you know, top of the second, mid-second picks.
Bro, it's going to get to the point where there is going to be no salary caps. It's going to get to the point where the NFL is just going to go, okay, are you okay with paying this luxury tax? Cool, we're going to make the money off of it. Because, bro, Deshaun Watson just got $250 million.
That's insane.
Think about that.
Yeah.
$250 million. Some of these Michael Jordan, some of these guys, didn't even sniff a percentage of that type of money. They did with their merchandise and everything down the road. But as players, bro, $250 million is insane. That's what I'm saying. It's going to get to the point where, hey, no, just pay their luxury tax.
Hill is getting $72.5 million starting 2023. He is getting $52.5 million today at signing, fully guaranteed.
So my cousin just sent me a meme, and I'll post it on social media here shortly. It's Tua on the floor with the football, and it's got the Michael Jordan crying face, and it says, Tua seen Tariq Hill 60 yards downfield knowing damn well he can't throw it that far. I'm sorry, bro. I had to throw that out there. That was hilarious. But
yeah,
we're basically running out of time here, though, man. We're at the end. Another thing that I will say real quick about Miami, McDonald, is that his name? The coach that they just got from the Niners? Is that his last name?
I'm not sure.
Quan? The coach that the Dolphins
McDaniels?
Just got from, is it McDaniels?
Yeah, McDaniel. Mike McDaniel.
Dude, he's legit. He is legit.
A little awkward, but
The day that I saw him in the press conference and he was like, Mike? Wait, Mike? Who? Mike Jones? Bro, I looked it up. You know he's half black. He's biracial. So when I saw it, I was like, that's awesome, bro. This dude is cool. He's laid back. He's chill. He's awesome. He's about the culture in Miami is what I'm seeing. So we'll see. I'm a Jets fan, so I obviously don't want to see Miami get hot or get good here, but it's good to see young new faces, bro. And I think that he is one of those young new faces that will succeed. And the fact that they're putting this type of talent around him for his first season, I think it's good. I think Tariq Hill going to Miami is a good spot because you're giving Tua that security blanket. Tariq can come out of the backfield if you want. He's that slant guy. He's that little streaker from the backside. He can do it all, if we're being honest.
Yeah.
So you're going to give Tua that security blanket more than anything because you don't have that running back that is their security blanket. So Tariq Hill can be that guy. It's going to be an interesting season, to say the least.
Are the Patriots the worst in that division?
No, the New York Jets are still the worst. I'm not trying to be funny. It's Buffalo, Miami, New England, and then the Jets, if I'm being honest. But the Miami, New England is right there.
Because Patriots lost a lot of people.
Gilmore coming to Vegas. You saw that?
Yeah.
Which we're going to talk about that next week.
Patriots lost a lot, and then they didn't regain a lot in free agency, at least so far, so. We'll see. Free agency's not over. There's still a lot of big names on the list. So
what you got, man? We got to go ahead and get on out of here.
Just
when you're
make
having
sure
fun,
you guys
time
are
flies.
Following us. EMB_sports, Jose Vellante. Make sure that you guys are retweeting us, following us. If you see us in a space, join in, hop in, say hi. If you have a question that you want answered on the show, you can DM one of us. We'll see if we can put it in the next show. So just be interactive, and we'll make sure to get to you guys.
That's right, man. Good stuff. Appreciate our guest, Okoye Dickson, Los Angeles Dodgers minor league batting coach. We greatly appreciate you for coming on the show. We got a lot more guests coming up, man. We got Spin Docs from Spin Doc Sports coming on with us next week. Talk some college, talk some betting, obviously. We love having them on the show. We've had them on before. Good stuff there. But before we finish up, man, I'm going to let you guys know, as I have the last couple of weeks, Straight Bet Sports, we are looking for sponsors. If you guys want to be a sponsor of the show, if you have a business or you know anyone that has a business that is looking to help promote their business and grow and be a part of something that's very inexpensive and easy for you to be a part of, and maybe the business is a sports fan, they're sports related, we have a lot of ideas, a lot of things that we could do for you. Go ahead and hit us up at straightbetsports@outlook.com. if not, you can check me out and hit me up and DM me on all things social media. Jose Vellante, I'm all over the place. Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, TikTok, Snapchat. Just look me up, man. I'm there. Any way that you like to have fun on social media, DM me there and we'll let you know all of the details. But I'm going to end it with this, man. The tournament starts tomorrow, the Sweet 16, right? That part of the tournament. A lot of big games tomorrow. I'm going to call it now. Arkansas beats Gonzaga. There's my upset. I think Villanova rose Michigan. I have Villanova winning the whole thing in my bracket. I'm still going to ride with them. I think they're the best team and the best coach team left in the tournament. I think
that's a
Duke goes down tomorrow as well. I think Texas Tech takes him out. I think Coach K's run is over, and we finally give the farewell tour an end. And don't sleep on Houston, man. Arizona has had some tough games leading into this game. Houston is legit. I'm not going to call that one just yet, but I think that's a fun game to watch if you're a bettor. Watch that game. Bet it live. You'll get a lot more action. It's only -1.5 right now for Arizona, but I can see that game going either way. But again, for Jose V, EMB, Quan 5'9", you have been tuning in another episode here on Gorilla Cross Radio, Straight Bet Sports. Till next week, same bat time, same bat channel. Peace.
Later.